Hi guys, in this lesson I'm going to cover the details about the SAA-C03 exam so that you understand what to expect when you go and sit your exam and what you're going to need to know before you go and sit your exam. I'll also cover the differences between the older version, the CO2 and the CO3. The exam is changing and the last day to take the CO2 exam is August 29th, 2022. Then registration is open for the C03 exam from July 26th, and the first day to actually take the new exam is August the 30th. Now it's nothing to worry about, they've just revised some of the topics that are included, and I'll go over the details shortly. So the CO3 exam is an associate level exam. Now, of course, CO2 or CO3, it really doesn't matter. It's still the Solutions Architect Associate exam. It's designed for that specific job role, and it's an associate level exam. It's 130 minutes long, and you get 65 questions. The cost is $150. If you've previously taken another exam, then make sure you use your exam voucher, which will discount that by 50%. The delivery method is either through a testing center or online with proctoring. Scoring is scaled between 100 and 1,000 points, and the minimum passing score is 720 points, so 72%. The question format is multiple choice, which means you have four answers, one of them is correct and the other three are incorrect, or multiple response, which means you have five or more answers and you have to select two or more, and you'll be instructed as to how many answers you need to select. Now, there is no other form of testing. There's no hands-on testing. It's purely a multiple choice and multiple response exam format. So let's have a look at the differences between the older version, the CO2, and the C03 version of the exam. Now, AWS uses exam domains. The domains are essentially the knowledge areas, and there are four domains for both exams. Now, the domains are almost identical in naming, and the weightings are slightly different between the exams. Also, the order is different. So we can see, for example, Design Resilient Architectures is domain 1 for the CO2, and it's domain 2 for the CO3. Now, I've highlighted the word applications in domain 3 on the left-hand side for CO2. That is the only word that's different. And of course, it makes sense that they are almost identical because it's still the Solutions Architect Associate exam. It's still meant for people who are performing a Solutions Architect role. But over time, things do change a little bit. AWS is constantly evolving and releasing new services and features. So with the exam update, they release a new pool of questions that test you on a few new knowledge areas. So let's have a look at what is covered in the exam. In domain 1 for secure architectures, the first task statement is that you need to know how to design secure access to AWS resources. You need to know how to design secure workloads and applications and determine appropriate data security controls. For domain 2, design resilient architectures, you need to know how to design scalable and loosely coupled architectures and highly available and or fault tolerant architectures. For domain 3, design high performing architectures, you need to know how to determine the high performing and or scalable storage solutions that are appropriate for the requirements presented. You need to know how to design high performing and elastic compute solutions, and how to determine high performing database solutions, and high performing and or scalable network architectures as well. Lastly, you need to know how to determine high performing data ingestion and transformation solutions. Then in domain 4, the final domain, you need to know how to design cost-optimized architectures. You need to know how to design cost-optimized storage solutions, cost-optimized compute solutions, and cost-optimized database solutions, and of course, cost-optimized network architectures as well. Now let's just have a quick look over the exam guide for the SAA-C03. You can find this on the AWS website, and I'll also add a link to the lesson. Now, if you scroll down, what you'll see is a lot of the information we've already covered, such as the response types, format of the exam. There's a note here on the unscored content, so note that about 15 of the 65 questions actually don't affect your score. And then it comes down a bit further and you can see the content outline. Now it does then go into a lot more detail than I covered in terms of the individual domains and each of the task statements. So feel free to have a look through and understand better the knowledge that's required and the skills that are required. Now I'm just going to scroll a bit further down because what I want to show you is the services that are in scope for the exam. I've scrolled down to the appendix and here it shows us the tools, technologies and concepts that might be covered on the exam. So what we can see here is a list of the actual services that could come up on the exam. So what's new for the CO3? Now what you'll find is most of the services were already covered on the CO2, but there are quite a few new services now, such as Lake Formation, Amazon MSK. Let's scroll down a bit further. AppSync came up occasionally on the old exam, but AppFlow I think is new for the CO3. Scroll down a bit further, we've got VMware Cloud on AWS, that's a new addition. And then further down here under containers, we've got things like EKS Anywhere and EKS Distro and ECS Anywhere, which are new concepts that have just started coming into the exam with the CO3. There are also some additional database services like Keyspaces and Neptune and the Quantum Ledger database that weren't really covered before, along with TimeStream as well. X-Ray is a developer tool for tracing, that's starting to come up in the new exam as well, and AWS Amplify, as well as Pinpoint. And machine learning, which wasn't really covered in the CO2, but now it is covered, and I expect the coverage to be very light in terms of the depth of knowledge you need. Under management and governance, we've got services like the managed Grafana service, the managed service for Prometheus, as well as AWS Proton. Those are new additions to the exam. For migration and transfer, it's very similar to what we had in the CO2. I don't think much has changed there. Under networking, again, this is very similar. I don't see any changes here. All of these services were already in scope for the CO2. And under security, most of these were already covered as well, so probably not too much of a change there. We then have serverless with AppSync making an addition to the exam. And for storage, these were all covered in the CO2, so not really any changes there. And then the last part of the exam guide tells you the services that aren't in scope. So that's it for this lesson. I just wanted to help you to understand what's in scope and of course all of the services that are in scope for both the CO2 and the CO3 are covered in the course, so you've got everything you need to successfully pass this exam.